Okay, hi everyone. This is Tal Frankfurt with Cloud for Good. Thank you for joining us today. You are all in a mute mode, but you can feel free to use the chat window if you have any questions during or after the presentation. I'm going to start with a brief introduction of the two companies that developed Over the Edge, and then we're going to switch to a live demo. We're going to do a complete Raises Edge migration to Salesforce today. So, again, my name is Tal Frankfurt with Cloud for Good. Cloud for Good works exclusively with nonprofit organizations and educational institutions to implement both Salesforce.com and Google Apps solutions. We basically provide the full CRM implementation services from discovery to design, customization, data migration, training, and ongoing support. A few months ago, while I was actually reflecting on the probably around 200 implementations that we've done with nonprofit organizations, and I was just thinking about what is our main challenge with implementing new databases. Where are our clients? Where does the process start? And then I quickly realized that the data migration is probably the most painful part of the implementation. So in order to address that issue, I approached Apsona. Apsona is a Salesforce ISV partner. They develop different applications on the force.com platform, and I think that they're most known for their Apsona for Salesforce application. That is basically an additional layer on top of the Salesforce interface that allows you to do better reporting, better data manipulation, cross-object filtering, and more. They were very excited, and we immediately started working on a solution that we believe is going to change the way CRM implementations and Salesforce migrations are currently working. So together, what we've done, we created Over the Edge. And Over the Edge is an easy-to-use, step-by-step tool that allows you to extract, transform, and load data from Raises Edge into Salesforce. We started with Raises Edge because we've had a lot of, Cloud for Good had a lot of recent inquiries about migrating from Raises Edge to Salesforce. We have a lot of experience migrating clients from Raises Edge to Salesforce. And we also wanted to challenge ourselves. You know, Raises Edge migrations, if you've done that before, you know that it requires a lot of hands-on data manipulation. You have to write scripts, and so you have to actually engage with someone, with a developer that knows SQL to write the scripts and then pull all the scripts out of Raises Edge, manipulate them, and only then load them. So we chose, I think, one of the more complex databases available today for a nonprofit. So we chose that as our starting point. And we also built a mapping to the nonprofit starter pack. So this is basically our first mapping. We have other products and other Salesforce configurations in mind and other solutions that we're working on today. So that's what I'm going to show you today. We're going to log in into actually a real Raises Edge environment. We're going to install Over the Edge, and then we're going to go through four clicks and probably around 20 minutes, and we're going to migrate an entire Raises Edge instance into Salesforce. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to share my desktop with you, and I'm going to switch to a live demo. Okay, you should be able to see the screen. We're actually remotely logging into another server that we're using for this demo, Raises Edge, a client server solution. And I already downloaded our Over the Edge application. It's a really small file. It's around 30 megabytes. So basically, once you contact us and you purchase the Over the Edge license, you'll receive this the file, the folder. You'll need to extract it and enter the security key that we'll give you, the access code. I'm just going to create a folder on my in my C drive, and I'm just going to copy all these files to this folder. So I'm extracting this file. we're really going through the entire process here. While this is installing, I want to show you a clean Salesforce nonprofit starter pack instance that I just registered for yesterday. We have done zero customization on this Salesforce instance except for two changes. We deactivated the automatic creation of households, and we deactivated the automatic creation of payments. Other than that, we have not done any change to the instance. I just want to show you, because we're starting our magic show here, that we're not hiding any fields. The data here is clean. We don't have anything in our sleeves. So donations is empty. Organizations is empty. This is a clean instance. There's one simple contact here. Clean instance without data. These are the values that are the records that come out of the box with the nonprofit starter pack. Okay. So finished installing or unzipping our over-the-edge application. I'm just going to start it. Once I started the application, the entire interface is actually web-based, so I just need to enter this URL, and it takes me to my first screen. See, it's a little slow because we are connecting remotely. After you accept the terms, we're now starting the migration. So first step is to enter your Salesforce username, password, and security token, and to connect to your server, and choose your Razor's Edge database. By the way, if you are using the hosted version of Razor's Edge, all you need to do is just to ask for the backup file, and you can do the entire thing with your backup file. So click Next. I just completed 25% of the data migration. What do we see here? So we see a lot of things. So here are all the Salesforce out-of-the-box standard objects or the nonprofit starter pack objects. And we can also see all the Razor's Edge tables as well. Now, as you can see, if you're familiar with Razor's Edge, we've done much more than just showing the Razor's Edge tables. We've already manipulated at this stage. We've already manipulated the data and created basically a flat file. So if you ever done an export from Razor's Edge, you know that, for example, contact information is not stored on the same table as the phone numbers, and the phone numbers are not on the same table as the address fields. So we've already transformed all this data, and let's say that you don't want to use our tool to do the actual import. You want to do some additional manipulations, or maybe you don't want to import it to the nonprofit starter pack. You don't really have to use it in the next steps. What I've just did, I downloaded while I was talking, all the organizations from Razor's Edge with the Razor's Edge ID. So you can do that for each one of the tables in Razor's Edge. We're basically extracting the data and already transforming it. Additionally, what I can do, if I click on each one of these blue objects, you'll see that all the fields and objects in Salesforce, all the contact fields here in Salesforce, are automatically available. So you can see on the right side all the Salesforce fields. If you were using a clean Salesforce instance right now, just out of the box nonprofit starter pack, but if you have done customization, that will automatically be available here. Okay, so any additional fields that you're creating in Salesforce will automatically be available in this column. The left side, you can see all the Razor's Edge fields. So you can see the multiple address ones, you can see the phones, and an additional suffix, salutations, and so on. You can also see, if I clicked on the map fields, that we've done some of the work for you as well. So we've already mapped many fields in the database in with this tool. So we already mapped the first name, the last name, and the birth date, and so on. That's on the contacts. We've done some mapping on donations as well. So I have one view that shows me all fields, or I can see only the map fields. So right now, I'm not even going to map anything because we haven't created anything in the system. I'm just going to use the over-the-edge, out-of-the-box mapping. Click Next. So So at this stage, we've already completed 50% of the data migration. And we added this step because there are a few nonprofit starter pack specific settings that we need to set. So first of all, do we want to create household records? So yes, I do want to create household records. If you're not familiar with a nonprofit starter pack, the household is basically a custom object. It's a place for you to aggregate number of contacts that share the same address. So by clicking yes, we're actually doing much more than just creating households in the system. We're taking the spouses from the contacts table in Razor's Edge, and we're adding the spouse under the same household. I do want to mark all the payments as paid, and I want to set, in the nonprofit starter pack, you need to set your preferred phone and preferred email, and we can set the donation stage to posted. I can also download the field mapping if I want, so I can download it, make sure that I have everything mapped correctly in Excel, and then maybe revisit, go back to the previous step. Let's click on next. So we've done 75% of the migration already, and now when I'm clicking on migrate, we're basically starting the migration. So right now you can see that our organizations are being imported. The next phase is going to be contacts, and so on. That is basically the migration from Razor's Edge to Salesforce. While it is working, I'm going to go back to my slides and talk about pricing. So how are we basically pricing this tool? So the basic package is going to cost $5,000. That is assuming that you have up to 10,000 constituents, 10,000 people in your database. That does not include all the gifts and so on. We're starting with we're looking only at the constituents. You can use it with a nonprofit starter pack. To be honest, you don't have to use it with a nonprofit starter pack. As I showed you, you can export all the fields, all the data, and then import it with Apsona for Salesforce, the data loader, or any other tool. Right now, we are, as you saw in my last screen, we're importing constituents and gifts and relations and campaigns and appeals, and we also have a few other tables that we are out of the box we're importing. There are additional costs for every additional 10,000 constituents and additional Razor's Edge tables. Your only additional costs are if you have more than 10,000 constituents in your database, and if you've done some customization to your Razor's Edge instance and you need some more hands-on adjustments to over the edge. That's the pricing. I'm going to go back to our over the edge instance, and I'm actually going to open it to questions as well. So let's see if I can figure out how to unmute everyone.
The conference has been unmuted.
Okay. Now you should all be able to ask questions. Any questions?
I just
anyone? Go ahead.
Yeah, I just put a question on the ReadyTalk conference, the webpage, but I can just repeat it here. If I were to do this migration one time, and I needed to later update that my database, is it possible to do that, a second update later, and is it easy enough to do without, creating duplicates of what I had already brought over into Salesforce?
Yes. So we actually, so There are two approaches here. First of all, if you use the tool for the import and you're going to do the second migration with the tool, then we actually remember the previous migrations. The other thing that you can do is to just import the Raises Edge ID. You can create a field in Salesforce for the Raises Edge ID and just use that for the duplication.
Mm. Okay.
Okay. Sridhar, are you here too on the line?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Do you want to? Do you have anything else, Sridhar, from Apsona? Do you have anything else to add?
That's it. You said the right thing.
I have a question. If you use the external, like if you create an external ID to bring over the Raises Edge key, does it is it performing upserts then, or is it doing inserts and updates? What Salesforce call is it making?
It depends on the tool. If you'll let's say that you do your initial migration with over the edge, and you bring the Raises Edge ID, and then you want to do additional migrations, and I don't know, let's say you want to use data loader, then you can choose yourself if you want to do an upsert or insert or anything else.
So is over the edge only performing inserts then?
Yes. It does carry over the Raises Edge ID, though, so that you can use it as an external ID if you wanted to later.
So once you load the, so since they're only performing inserts, you can't use over the edge you would only be able to use over the edge to add additional records. You're not performing any kind of updates if we brought over a new or an old record.
Where will you bring the records from?
Well, I'm just thinking in terms of if we had to run the job and then we found that we had to make some changes to the mapping or something and we wanted to update the existing records, we can't use Over the Edge to rerun the job essentially and perform those updates.
That's a good question, actually. I think it's a very straightforward feature to add to be able to give you an option to say just update these objects, not insert. Assuming, of course, that you've created the, you've brought in the Raises ID.
Right, but so that can be on our roadmap, but you can potentially delete everything and start again. Like, you can actually delete your entire, don't forget that doing the data migration, it's not going to take you weeks. We're going to finish this in the next, donations is the largest file, is the largest one here. It's going to run after this, but you can actually delete everything and do an entire data migration again.
And then is there a place to perform transformations, or is this just a straight field mapping? So I'm just saying this is the source, this is the target, move it, or is there a place where we can apply transformations to the data?
That's a good question. So if you decide to use the tool from step one to step four, all the way from step one to step four, you don't have a place to do transformation. That is on our roadmap as well, by the way. If you stop at step two, what I showed you earlier when I downloaded the Excel file, so you can download all these files, do the transformation using these files, and then you can use any other data loader type of application to bring these files into Salesforce.
And how are the files structured? Are they structured based on the source database? So Raises Edge database, you get a file per
No.
table, or how is the Excel?
No, it's structured based on Salesforce. So
on the nonprofit structure, though, correct?
Yes and no. It's actually not based on the starter pack. It's based on if you do the export in step two. It's based on the standard Salesforce, configure the schema. If you downloaded contacts, the contacts Excel, it will have the phones and emails and addresses and so on. There is really nothing except for the households that is different.
Okay. All right.
So one of the concerns there is that in Raises Edge, you can have arbitrarily many phone numbers and arbitrarily many email addresses and so on, whereas in Salesforce, you have a certain fixed number. And those are repeated within the contact record. So you have a home address and a work address and that sort of thing. So what this extraction tool does is transform the data before providing the CSV so that you will have columnar formatted address rather than by rows. So you'll see if you downloaded the contact CSV, you would see a set of columns for home address and a set of contacts for work address and a set of columns for vacation address if that's what you've configured within within your resource edge. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. So we're doing the mapping, or we're applying the mapping though before the CSV is extracted, correct? So if we need to move a field to a different, you know, a custom field, we define that first and then perform the extract. Is that correct?
The extract actually happens dynamically during the migration. You can either download the CSV
right,
in extracted form.
Yeah.
Or you can simply do a migrate, and the extraction happens during the migration. So what you're seeing is really a live copy. It's copying from source to destination, and while doing the extraction on the fly.
Right, and I'm sorry, I used the wrong term. When I said extraction, I meant creating a CSV file. So you're essentially either creating a CSV or you're writing directly to Salesforce.
Correct, exactly.
Okay, got it.
Is there any way we could see that that flat table that you created?
Sure.
I downloaded the let's do that in a second because this is not my computer. We're connecting to another server, and I'll download it again and show you the CSV file. Which table are you specifically interested in?
Well, just based on what your colleague said, the contact table would be great.
Okay, sure. We'll do that. We're almost done with the migration.
Okay. So feel free to put that to the group if there's something else they'd like to see.
Okay. Let's look at Salesforce for a second while it's still working on affiliations and relationships. So I can see that now when I look at organizations, we have organizations in Salesforce. We have donations in Salesforce. More than 2,000, you can see. We have all the campaigns. Do we have the campaigns already? Might be still bringing them. Here you go. Here are all the campaigns. Can see that we are creating the donations, associating the donations to the campaigns. Well, by the way, these are appeals in Razor's Edge. And we also created campaign members for all the donors. We're almost done. So you can see that all the data was imported to Salesforce.
I've got a quick question. How would split gifts be handled if they were split between multiple campaigns or funds?
How would a split gift, if a gift, are you talking about a gift is split between the funds? So the nonprofit startup, well, from our experience, there is not a lot of split between different appeals. The split is between funds in Razor's Edge. And the nonprofit starter pack does not have this functionality of splitting, right? The nonprofit starter pack doesn't have the capability to split one donation to multiple funds. So this is something that we will need to work with the specific client. So if it's a common ground designations, that's something that something that we need to build, or actually Cloud for Good as a donation split module that is free on the AppExchange that allows you to split the gift to multiple designations and multiple budget tiers, that will be included as part of the as part of over the edge, this mapping.
Thanks.
So let's go to you want to download Contacts? Contacts is, let's do that. It's 5,000. Might take a few minutes. It might take a few minutes to download this file. It's a large file. You can download organizations while I'm talking. Any other questions while we're downloading? Okay, this is the organizations tab, the organizations table. While we're waiting for the context to be created. So you can see the import ID, organization name, the addresses. By the way, it brings the home address too. So if you are using Common Ground, you can use that to create your households.
Would it include the organization key, the Razor's Edge key for the account?
Yes,
would that
it does.
Be on the contact as well?
Sridhar, is that the organization is on the contact?
They're both record ID.
Okay.
Assuming that's what you're asking, there is a record.
Yep.
In Razor's Edge, there's only one object that contains both organizations and contacts. And there's a record ID associated with that. And yes, that is brought in.
So is it one contact per organization record, or is it multiple contacts on a single organization record?
There is a notion of a relationship between contacts and organizations in Razor's Edge.
Yeah.
And that relationship is maintained and imported. So
it is
as many contacts.
Okay, great.
Yes. Whatever the relationship is in Razor's Edge gets carried over to Salesforce.
Got it.
Any other questions?
Do you do anything with pledges and recurring giving?
Here's the contact. Pledges and recurring giving, not at the moment. It's probably something that we're going to do once we're going to do a mapping to Common Ground. So if it's a specific case, that's something that we can build specifically for you. You can just download it from here and I'll do the mapping. The mapping is something that we'll need to custom build for Common Ground. I'm assuming that's what you're referring to.
Well, Nonprofit Starter Pack also has recurring built in.
The thing with the Nonprofit Starter Pack recurring gift built in is that all the apps that integrate with online giving create their own recurring giving tables. So if we decide that we map to the Salesforce ones, to the Nonprofit Starter Pack ones, you're going to have a problem with all the other applications. So that is a question, do we map to Click and Pledge, or we map to Payment Connect, or I don't know, or anyone else?
I have a question. For gifts, are you able to attribute them to campaign, appeal, and package?
Campaign, appeal, and package, yes. Yep.
And do you use campaign hierarchy to reflect that, or does it just become an attribute of the gift record?
It's an attribute of the gift record.
Are soft credits still held too on the gift record is brought across?
Yes. Here is the contact. I don't know who asked about it earlier. Here's the contact table.
So can you show us what you're talking about with the infinite many phone numbers and how that works?
Mm. So you can see that we brought all the addresses here. It's all in one table. So there are infinite phone numbers. These are actual mailing addresses.
Then are you
same thing?
Are you creating the fields in Salesforce?
We are not creating any field in Salesforce. We are mapping field. We are mapping from Razor's Edge to whatever you create in Salesforce. So this packet, this over the edge, does not create any fields or objects, or it gives you the flexibility to do that. So if you create additional address fields or additional phone fields or additional email fields, over the edge will map to them.
So probably as part of my my process, I would have to download this file, see what addresses I have, create the fields in Salesforce, and then go through it again and do the mapping, right?
Yes, unless you're working, the implementation is much more than just data migration. So there should be. We still, we're giving you here a solution. That's my consulting hat is putting it that for a second. We're giving you a solution to import Razor's Edge to Salesforce, and actually we did it today in less than 30 minutes. Implementation is much more a data migration. It's a culture change. You need to go through some discovery, make sure that you. I'm not sure that you want to copy exactly the way that you worked with Razor's Edge and bring it into Salesforce. So there needs to be some thinking process there about your business processes and the way that you want to track the information. So, but one way would be to, that's a good place to start, to download everything the way that it is in Razor's Edge and then think about it and then maybe create it in Salesforce.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, unless there are more questions, I think we can. Are there any other questions? Srita, would you like to add some?
I'm sorry, one last question. At this point, are there any limitations in terms of number of records coming from Razor's Edge?
No. There should be no limitations on number of records. It will take more than 30 minutes, though. So it might take you an hour and a half. But there is no limit on the number of records, as far as we know. Sridhar, anything you want to add?
Tal, could I ask another question?
Go ahead.
So I'm just trying to get a sense of the developer aspect of creating the scripts and the SQL queries that you are allowing me using this to skip. So when I'm looking at something like the contacts table, is there any sense you could give me of how many different tables you've flattened from Razor's Edge onto that CSV file?
I think there's three of them. When it comes to the contact record, there is a records table, there is a phone table, and there is the address table. And email addresses are stored within the phone table within in Razor's Edge. And so those three are flattened out, but we need to do a little extra processing to get the pivoting to work, right? Because we need to extract what are rows and make them into columns. So there's a bit of processing that happens there. It's not just a straightforward join.
Okay.
Yeah. Does that help? Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I mean, can you maybe fill in the picture a little bit more about what happens then for organizations? I just I want to get a better sense of what your tool is actually doing for me that the script would need to do.
Oh, it's basically the same deal. What it does is it as far as Razor's Edge is concerned, there is only one difference between contacts and organizations. There is one field called key indicator in the record field, in the record table. Which indicates what kind of record it is, whether it's if it has an I, it's an individual, if it has an O, it's an organization. And what this tool does is pull out the records from the record table, and it pulls out the records from the phone and address table and flips them over so that when you see a one-to-many relationship from the records table to, for example, the phone table, all of the corresponding records in the phone table are adjoined to the main output list as columns rather than as rows, so that you can see the infinitely many phone numbers, for example. And the type of phone number is looked up from another, table entries, I think is the name of the table, that contains the kinds of phone numbers and the kinds of addresses that are there. So I guess I lied, there are four different tables that it looks up.
Okay.
I don't know if that helps. Is there anything more specific you would like to ask?
Well, I mean, not being familiar with the data schema in Razor's Edge, this does give me some sense about how that's structured, at least in my imagination. So that is helpful to know what exactly the tool is doing, personally.
Okay. It does generate the SQL on the fly because it needs to know what fields are available and how to see it and so on. How to access them, rather.
Great.
Anyone else? Yeah, I feel like every time I ask that, there is an additional question. Anyone else? Okay, Shweta, do you want to say anything else?
Well, I'd love to hear feedback on this. What's the general thought on the tool as such? What's your feeling about its applicability? That sort of thing.
I actually have one more question really quick, and you may have answered this already. I apologize. Does it create, if you're exporting to CSV, does it only create those or include those fields that you have mapped? So if in your source, you know, there are fields that you don't use and you don't want to map those, obviously, the CSV file that gets created, does it include those source fields still, or does it only include those fields that you've mapped?
It includes everything. It does not include only the fields that you mapped.
Okay.
The intent is really that, as Tal said earlier, you would want to be able to use this tool with other situations, not necessarily with the nonprofit starter pack. So we couldn't limit ourselves to just the ones that you've mapped. You really need to extract all the data from the source database, and then you can use it any way you want.
Okay.
I have a question. Do you have any plans for expanding this product to other databases?
Absolutely.
Excellent. And then do you have any plans to also expand it into not just the nonprofit starter pack, but into enterprise version, for example?
So the enterprise version, we're looking right now We're looking right now at a few solutions. So we're looking at Common Ground and AffiniQuest. And actually, we didn't really think about just the enterprise version. I want to say that what the tool currently does should work with just the enterprise, just the standard enterprise without the nonprofit starter pack packages.
Mm-hmm.
The main difference between the starter pack and something like Common Ground is that you might have the householding is dealt a little differently. Plus, you have a lot of other functionalities that the starter pack does not have. For example, the fund that was mentioned earlier. With the standard CRM, you're not going to have all these functionalities. So you're not going to have households. You're not going to have payments. You're not going to have donations or some of the mapping for donations. So I'm not sure how it's going to work, if we actually need to do additional mapping just for the enterprise. But we're open there. I'd love to hear from you why you think we need to do it for the enterprise.
Well, I'm really thinking in terms of not even just Razor's Edge, but other databases. So, for example, I work a lot with implementing Foundation Connect.
Yes, we have had the call with Brad Hillis. I had a call with Brad Hillis last week.
Okay.
We'll consider MicroEdge as well.
I think that would be terrific.
Yeah. The question is, what is the? It's it's a volume question.
Exactly.
How many
true.
MicroEdge? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know how long it took you to develop this, and whether there's a cost benefit for that or. Right. I just thought, since you've already developed a tool, maybe it's easier to tweak it for something else, some other purpose.
it's definitely easier because we've done most of the work, and it's the, and as I said, it's we definitely have additional databases in our that we're considering right now.
Excellent, great, thank you.
From the developer perspective, a lot of scaffolding is in place. It's many of the mapping building mechanisms and mapping maintenance mechanisms are all parameterized away from the code. So there's not a whole lot of refactoring we need to do when we need to move to another source database or another target database.
Right.
There is some data massaging happening here. Like Cass said earlier, it needs to do things like aggregating the contact and their spouse under the same household. And that's a bit of work that's special to Raiser's Edge. It's obviously not generic to carry across the other databases.
Right.
But that sort of thing, is the code is set up sufficiently, what do I say? The code is set up in a way that we have broken out those pieces. So we could inject other pieces if we wanted to talk to other source and target databases.
I see, okay. Great, looking forward to it.
Can we take a look at the resulting contact in Oregon in Salesforce?
We can. I'm going to do it really quickly. Let's see if I need to. Share desktop again. Okay. Is there anything specific that you want to see about them, or?
I just like to see how the CSV translated into Salesforce and what the layout ended up being and how it connects to the org and the household.
Well, the okay. So you can see that we created a contact, we updated his email and phone. You can see that all the donation roll-ups are working. This is, by the way, all fake information. All the donation roll-ups are working here. We created a household. Under the household, we created his wife. We added all his address. We also created the relationship, by the way, between him and his wife. So that's another thing that we didn't mention. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's basically mapped to any of the fields that exist.
And did you create a household for every contact from Raiser's Edge, or is it using the household settings from the nonprofit starter pack?
We turned off the automatic household creations, and we created a household for every contact in Raiser's Edge. And place the spouse under the same household.
Okay.
That's if you choose. In step 3, you can actually choose if you want to do it or not.
But it's sort of all or nothing. I know there's a nonprofit startup pack setting, create households for individuals. So this is creating it even if you're associated with an organization record, it seems like.
Yes, in this instance it does. Again, you can very easily delete all the households that are associated for contacts that are associated with organizations if you need to.
Sure, okay.
So I'm a little bit confused on that question. Are you saying that my understanding was that go ahead.
The starter pack has 3 options for creating households. You can create a household for no contacts, all new or edited contacts, or just individual contacts. Mm-hmm. Individual contacts are contacts that don't have an organization. Maybe it's something that we can add, by the way. Contacts that don't have an organization associated with them. In Raiser's Edge, you can do that.
I mean, it would save me the step of having to find them and delete them, so that would be nice.
Okay. Anyone else? Any additional questions? Great. So I want to thank you all for joining us today. The apps, Over the Edge, by the way, is available on the App Exchange since yesterday. So you can contact us through the App Exchange, or you can contact us directly. Thank you very much for your time. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please stand by.